And today I'll be talking to you about the evolution of chemical signals in neotropical piper within the context of ecological interactions with bats. So first let me start out by introducing the characters. So these are piper plants. There's actually about 2,000 species of these guys in the world. The typical one is kind of like this, little small trees and fruits. Look like this, we'll be talking a lot about fruits. They're all small things. But there can be a lot of variation. There can be vines or lianas. They can be little tiny shrubs. They can be pretty big trees with fruits that are like that big. Most of the fruits are white or green, but sometimes they can even be pink or red. So there's a lot of variation in these guys. But the neatest thing about them is that a lot of the neotropical piper species actually have a mutualism with bats, and their seeds germinate a lot better if they go through a bat's digestive system. And for the bats, for this species, Caerulea castanea, the piper provide about 3/4 of their diet, and these guys love their piper. Like you can see, he's being held. I wouldn't want to eat him if I was being held, but he's just like, you can actually see his belly growing. So they're a good study system for experiments because they will eat in a lot of conditions. So what we know so far, we know that plants need dispersers, that piper plants send signals used by bats, and we think they're scent signals, and that scents can be common or distinct in closely related species of plants. So the project I work on is a pretty cool and big project. It's about the adaptive scenario linking plant signals, sensory abilities, and behavior. And it spans three labs, Charlene Santana's lab at the University of Washington, Jeffrey Fell's lab also there, and Liliana Navolos from Stony Brook. And my part of it is basically characterizing the scents and figuring out how which ones the bats are interested in. So when I talk about scents, I'm talking about VOCs. These are volatile organic chemicals. They are nonpolar, they're small, and they're found in all living things, and they easily become vapors. So I'll be like using scent and VOC interchangeably. So our main questions for this part of the project is, what is the scent composition of piper plants? And is the scent composition correlated with the phylogeny of piper plants? And do the bats prefer piper species that are more closely related, or ones that smell more similar, or a combination of the both? So to study this, we go to Costa Rica to La Selva Biological Field Station. And we have a lot of fun. And for part of the project that Al Gadsden in our lab, Leif Miller is leading, we catch bats and figure out what they're actually eating. So we caught 495 individuals of the species, collected fecal samples, and then we got to sort and identify them in the lab. And you can see some are very similar, hard to identify, some are very different. You get little tiny triangle ones, you get round ones, you get, all sorts. So with this, we'll know what the bats are actually eating. For the other parts, we're collecting plants for herbarium samples, so we always have vouchers, and leaves for DNA, so that we'll know how they're related. And then we collect the scents from ripe fruit, unripe fruit, and vegetation. And so far, we've done 3 field seasons and collected 230 individuals representing 36 species. And we surveyed the VOCs for ripe, unripe fruit, and vegetation for about 20 species, because not all of them were had ripe fruit when we were around. And then for the to get the phylogeny of the piper plants, so far I've just sequenced the chloroplast intron for 86 individuals representing 36 species. This will probably at least double in size, and we'll add more genes, but for now that's what we have. To collect the scents, we put the leaves or the fruits in a bag, and we put hook it up to a little scent trap and a pump and filters to circle air through, and then the run for about 20 hours so that the scent gets concentrated and we can find out what it is. Then we extract it from the trap using X-ray and put it on a GCMS and we find out what they are. So for the first part of the project, least part, she found out that they did in fact use about a piper for about 78% of their diet, which is awesome, but then they use a lot of species. But then they mostly use only a few of the species. So then if we map this on to the piper phylogeny, you see that the species aren't completely spread out. So these are piper species just from La Selva, 36 out of the 44. And the pink are the highest proportions, so the ones that are eaten in highest proportion are about 15% of the diet. The black are 0%, it's dark green or like 2%. So most of them belong to two clades, and as a small aside, Sanctifolesis, the most common species at La Selva, is actually two species. And the fun part is that it comes out closest to other ones that the bats are eating in high proportions. So they eat about 7% of the diet is umbricola, and one clade comes out close to that. And about 8% of the diet is silvulegum, and comes out close to that. So that's pretty neat. Anyway, right. And then for the scents. So this is kind of what we get. We get these chromatograms with the abundance and the time, and they're separated by time. And each of these peaks represent to a chemical. And this is a fairly typical scent profile that we get. So there's hundreds of VOCs that compromise each scent profile, but only a few of them are in high abundance. These can be these tuba beans and caryophyllines. These are two completely different species, like one with fruits that are about that big and one with fruits that are just about that big. And they have very similar profiles. I'll just highlight this caryophyllene, which is a kind of a typical compound. It's a bicyclic. This one happens to be to cause the spiciness of black pepper. Oh yeah, I meant to tell you, piper, the piper you probably know best is black pepper, probably in most of your kitchens. So that's not great. Anyway, so this chemical causes the spiciness of black pepper. It is also the chemical that police use to train drug sniffing dogs to find marijuana. But they not only have these chemicals, they actually have quite a wide variety. Pinenes, phalandrine, silane. Highlighting this one, they're mostly also cyclical, sometimes monocyclic, sometimes bicyclic. This one is found in oil of eucalyptus, and it smells so pretty, has a nice fruity scent, that it's actually used in a lot of perfumes. So, if you look at this on the whole pipers, we find that there is about, compounds that are found in at least 10% abundance in a species and found in at least two species. And they're mostly cis-cluster beans and monotrope beans. And these boxes show presence-absence, and they're colored by the percentage of the diet, of that diet. So multiple nervum are found in 15% of the diet, so they're pink. Erdifolium aren't found at all, so they're black. So if you squint, you can think, maybe there's a pattern, I don't know, I think. Fortunately, we have statistics, which is awesome. So this is a modified PCA with Brake-Curtis distances, and if you do that, this is for all the scents, not just the 12 most common ones. You can see that they cluster four groups, and most of the ones that bats eat in highest proportion, this was, I think, 7%, 8%, 5%, 15% cluster in this one group. Sanctifolesis, this was the one that came out in two places. We only found that out about 2 days before the conference, so we haven't had a chance to separate out the scent profiles. So we don't know if that one will keep coming out in the middle, if it all smells like that, or if not. But it seems like the bats are queuing in on a particular scent profile. And this is driven by about four chemicals, the caryophyllene, phalandrine that I talked to you about, and silane, which which is, I think it's found in thyme. So that's cool. And even though these are made from all the chemicals that we found, not just the major ones, the ones that drive the pattern seem to be the ones found in highest abundance. I talk really fast. Okay. So in summary, species of piper that Caroline Castagna eat cluster phylogenetically. The piper species have distinct VOC signatures, and most of the piper species that Caroline Castagna eat seem to have similar scents. So this is great. Where do we go from here? So what we want to do next is, test if the scents are bat driven and stuff. And we will also be going back in the field and getting these chemicals that are different between ripe fruit and unripe fruit from these particular species. And hopefully the bats will choose some of them, and then we will know if they actually like some better or others. And with that, I'd like to thank Charlene and Jeff for making up this project and letting me work on it and including me in their labs. NSF, who provided funding, La Selva, where we do the field work, and University of Washington, where we are. And Jessica helped me a lot with codes. We've introduced me to bats. Winnie also helped me with codes, and Chloe helped me use it to scan my squishy. So with that, we have about a million minutes, or 3.5, for questions. Thanks a lot. Are separate, which is cool. So far, our sample sizes are too small to do statistics on it, but just by eye, they totally cluster differently on NMDS plots. The ripe fruit and unripe fruit, I can't tell them apart. They look the same. NMDS plots seem to think they're the same, but the bats can definitely tell the difference. When we did flight cage experiments and put fruit pulp of a ripe fruit on a dummy fruit and a fruit pulp of an unripe fruit, they went. Almost all of them went to the ripe fruit, so they could definitely tell. So now I've been trying to match up the profiles of the ripe fruit and the unripe fruit for the most common one, the Sanctiphilesis. And it seems like there might be three chemicals different, and we want to test those next field season. But so far, I'm not sure because I was counting both the species as one, so we will find out very soon. So today I talked about just one, the one that eats it in highest abundance. At La Selva, there's three species in one genus that all eat it, and they all eat it in different proportions. So later we'll be able to do studies to see if they're all attracted to the same thing. Or,
exactly. And then have you thought, just following up on the previous talk, thinking about character displacement possibly in relation to the bats?
So far we don't see any evidence of that, but we are testing it. So to be continued, next evolution. Found that out 2 days before evolution meeting started.